Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Welcome to Ankeny United Church of Christ. No matter who you are, no matter where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. And I hope that this is a place and a time of healing and wholeness for you. And welcome to the special Transfiguration Sunday, which means Lent starts next week. So you will hear all about what we have going on in Lent at the latter end of the service when we talk about our commissioning. But suffice it to say, I hope you join us on our Lenten journey from here on out, all the way up until the empty tomb of Easter morning. So please join us for worship in the various events that we have going on. So I invite us to take a deep breath together. Let us feel the presence of God within and around us as together with the disciples we journey up to that mountaintop and see the transfiguration of Christ with our own eyes. Let us now gather together in this time of worship as we hear our words of welcome.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to Sunday worship at Ankeny United Church and for those watching at home at AnkenyUCC.org. We are a welcoming church family exploring progressive Christian theology, caring within and serving beyond. No matter who you are or where you are in life's journey, you're invited to walk with us this morning. And that means whether you are visiting for the first time or born and raised in this church or somewhere in between, you are welcome here. Whether you are excited for what the new year might bring or anxious about the uncertainty of the future, you are welcome here. Whether you are worn from travel or rested and ready to tackle life's big adventure, you are welcome here. Whether you are widowed, single, married, coupled, or somewhere in between, you are welcome here. No matter who you love, you are welcome here. No matter your gender identity or if you don't identify with a gender at all, you are welcome here. No matter where you or your family's ability or accessibility needs are, you are welcome here. Children of all ages and abilities are welcome here as well, and we never mind a little noise or disruption in service if it means there is sounds of life here. However, if you wish, we also have a staff nursery should you need it. This is the worship of God at Ankeny United Church, and we are so glad you're here. So I invite you to rise in body or in spirit to join us for the call to worship. Gathering in this sacred place, we give thanks to the God who is with us all of our lives.
The God of wonder is with us now.
On the mountaintop, we travel with the disciples to see the transfiguration of Christ with our own eyes.
The God of transformation is with us now.
The God of love has entered our lives, and we can no longer remain the same.
Let us gather to worship God.
And now please join us in the opening hymn 182 in the black hymnal or up on the screen. We have come at Christ's own bidding.
Away.
Good to be with you all. And so at this time, I invite you to turn to one another, and in whatever way of your choosing, let us pass the peace of Christ to one another this morning. Peace be with you. You may be seated as we have our reading of the Living Psalm.
Please join along in the responsive reading. From the rising of the sun to where it sets, God, the Lord God, speaks, calling out to the earth.
From Zion, perfect in beauty, God shines.
Our God is coming. He won't keep quiet. A devouring fire is before God. A storm rages all around God.
God calls out to the skies above and to the earth in order to judge God's people.
Bring my faithful to me, those who made a covenant with me by sacrifice.
The skies proclaim God's righteousness. Because God is the only judge.
As we prepare to enter into a time of worship where we lift up prayers for ourselves, our community, and our world, let us now join together as we sing our responsive prayer. Many thoughts in our hearts today, many prayers that rest heavily upon us, and so I ask if there are any prayers that we can lift up to be shared with our community on this day. Any prayers this morning? Yes.
Sort of a prayer of joy, but also continued prayers for Mark's niece, Rachel, who has the four kids and has been getting treated for colorectal cancer. She is through her chemo. It did shrink the tumor 50%. Mm. She just had met with her doctor. She does not have to do radiation. They're going to go straight to surgery, which the doctor wants to do before next month. So just prayers that that surgery goes smoothly. It's a 12-hour surgery. Pretty few days in the hospital with all those kids, just prayers for her that that takes care of it and that she can get home and get back to momming and lifing. So thank you.
For Rachel, for her family, for the surgery that waits ahead, for the healing and wholeness of God upon the entire family. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
I have a prayer for a young man named Berkeley. He's 22 years old. His mom is Betty Jean, and my brother Sean is his stepfather. Berkeley sustained what seemed like a relatively minor injury snowboarding, but it's progressed to what's called the flesh-eating bacteria. And his prognosis this morning is terribly grim, facing the prospect of losing both legs or even not surviving this. So Betty Jean lost her sister in December. My brother lost our father in December. So they're really pretty overwhelmed right now.
Yeah. For Berkeley, for the incredible fight ahead of him, for the family that has gone through so much, may they know that they are loved and not alone in this incredibly, incredibly difficult time, and may God's healing love be upon them all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Prayers for Brad, who is not feeling very well, and we very much miss him this morning.
Prayers for Brad that he heals, recovers, and that he knows just how much we appreciate him in his presence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Any other prayers? Will you please join me in the spirit of prayer? Gracious God, we with the disciples find our way journeying up the mountain, and we see something that we cannot comprehend, something that we cannot explain, something that defies all reason and logic, but we know what it is that we have seen. We have seen you at work in and amongst us. We have felt your presence as close to us, as near to us as the breath in our lungs. But God, even though there are those times that we have seen and felt and experienced you so clearly, we know that this life is full of struggle, and at times it can be hard to remember that you are present with us. As we lift up these prayers this morning, prayers for healing, for hope, prayers of sorrow and struggle, may you continue to remind us that you journey alongside us every step of our life's journey. But God, we know that there are just some prayers that are too powerful to be spoken aloud, and so we take a moment of silence as we lift up those prayers that rest in the deepest parts of our hearts. And so, God, as we lift up these prayers today, we know that you answer us when we call. And so we join together to sing our prayerful refrain. So now we join together in whatever language and tradition of our choosing, as together we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So at this time, I'm going to ask all of our young people to come forward and join me for young person's time. Come on up and have a seat. It is good to see you this morning. My question to you is, have you ever made a mistake before? I would expect. I feel like all of us have made mistakes. Have any of us made mistakes before? Yeah. You haven't, huh? Never. I think that's a big old fib, because I think you definitely have. We all have, right? We all have made mistakes. That's part of what makes us human. And you know, coming up into this week, there's going to be a very special day on Wednesday. It's special for two reasons. You know what's coming up on a Wednesday? Well, maybe. Your birthday's, I know you've had your birthday. You know what? There's two things there. That's right. One of the things is that it's Valentine's Day, and it's also something called Ash Wednesday. Now, you might go to school and you might see some kids that have a strange little cross on their forehead. And what that means is that they went to an Ash Wednesday service before going to school. And what that means and Ash Wednesday is all about is Ash Wednesday is all about asking for forgiveness. When we do something that we're not supposed to, when we make mistakes, we just say we're sorry, we ask for forgiveness, and we try to do better. Because none of us are perfect, right? We all make mistakes. Even your parents make mistakes. Even your grandparents, our best friends. We all do it from time to time, and that's perfectly okay. That's what makes us human. So if you see anyone on Ash Wednesday, on Valentine's Day, that might have a little cross on their forehead, now you know why. And if you want, you can always come to church before school starts if you want to get one of them yourself before going to school. But it might clash with some of the Valentine's Day, you know, decor. I know, it's not quite the same. We're going to do our special prayer. You remember how it goes?
Yeah.
We put our hands forward and we say, let us pray. Lord Jesus, be with us every day and help us grow in every way. Amen.
The scripture today is from 2 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 and 8 through 12. Now the Lord was going to take Elijah up to heaven in a windstorm, and Elijah and Elisha were leaving Gilgal. Elijah then took his coat, rolled it up, and hit the water. Then the water was divided in two. Both of them crossed over on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "What do you want me to do for you before I'm taken away from you?" Elijah said, "Let me have twice your spirit." Elijah said, "You've made a difficult request. If you can see me when I'm taken from you, then it will be yours. If you don't see me, it won't happen." They were walking along, talking, when suddenly a fiery chariot and fiery horses appeared and separated the two of them. When Elijah went to heaven in a windstorm, Elijah was watching, and he cried out, "Oh, my father, Israel's chariots and its riders." When he could no longer see him, Elisha took hold of his clothes and ripped them in two. Scriptures from Mark chapter 9, 2 through 9. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who was talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead.
Will you please join me in the spirit of prayer? Holy Word, holy wisdom, be in our hearts, in our understanding, and in our actions on this day. Amen. I was 16 years old at the time when my life changed forever. Now, I recognize some of you know the story, but others maybe not so much, of the moment in time when I decided I was going to become a pastor. I figure when we're talking about transfiguration, when we're talking about those life-altering moments, this is as good of time as any, right? But looking back, it's amazing what you think is important when you're 16 years old. You think your first love is your only love that you'll ever have. You think that high school is the most important time period of your life, hands down, bar none. You think you have the world figured out perfectly. At the time, and when I was 16 years old, before this happened, I had decided, you know, they try to get you thinking about what do you want to be, what do you want to do, what do you want to go to college for? You need to start preparing those college essays. And at the time, I told myself I was going to be a pharmacist. At least that was the profession I had chosen for myself that particular week. It changed quite frequently, right? But I decided I was going to be a pharmacist, even though I was terrible at science and math. I figured I could figure out a way around that, though, someday. At the time, even at 16, I had been active in the church my entire life. I had gone through confirmation. I was in the adult church choir at that point. I was active in our conference-wide youth program, one of those small world things I don't know how many of you know Jessica, who comes here with her kids and her husband and even her mom and dad, apparently, sometimes.
I met Jessica. She was in the Iowa Conference Youth as well, so seeing her now is sort of like a weird small world thing. But as active as I was, being at church on Wednesday nights for both services, Sunday mornings, helping out with the youth program and the Iowa Conference on the weekends, still, even then, religion was more of a hobby than an actual lifestyle for me. But in 2005, at the age of 16, now almost 20 years ago, which makes me feel so old, you can't even begin to tell you, 20 years ago, something happened to me. You see, I felt the presence of God, as real and as sure as the sun in the sky, for what might have been the very first time. That's interesting, right? Being so active and involved in church, having faith be such a big part of my life, but it wasn't until I was 16 years old that I can actually say I feel like I felt the presence of the divine for the very first time in my life. And it just so happens that it happened while I was making a trip with our Iowa Conference Youth Group to the General Synod that was taking place in Atlanta, Georgia. Our whole crew of Iowa Youth Conference delegates, we went on a big old chartered bus. We made many stops along the way, going to Cedar Point before heading down south and hitting all of the stops along the way. But one stop in particular was at the tomb of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. And if you've ever been there, now his wife is with him as well, and there's a little reflecting pool, a beautiful, serene space. And next to his resting place, there is this little museum that is dedicated to his life and his ministry, to who he was as a person. It felt like sacred ground. There was something different, something holy about that time and that place as we gathered together, even us 16-year-olds, which you can imagine a bunch of 16-year-olds on a bus for that long. We were finally anxious and ready to get out and move around, but even then, we behaved ourselves. It was a miracle. We walked around the museum. It held many of his personal artifacts, his Nobel Peace Prize, his Bibles, some of his manuscripts for his speeches, other belongings. But I remember it was standing in front of a plexiglass case that held his preaching robes that he wore on the Sunday before his assassination. Something happened to me. And it's impossible to describe. Right? It doesn't matter what I say. It doesn't matter how I try to phrase it. Words are just, by their very nature, going to fall short. But the closest thing I can come up with was that a piece of me deep within me felt like it was engulfed in a rushing wind. If you've ever been outside on a windy day and you find that one spot, like in a corner of a building or something, where the wind just whips around you and creates that sort of vortex. That's what it felt like deep inside me, in a part of me that I didn't know existed. And in that moment, my life changed. The whole trajectory of my life changed. I gave up my misguided dream of becoming a pharmacist, and I stopped treating my religion, my faith, like it was a hobby. From that moment on, that part of me knew that I needed to seriously consider and pursue ministry. In a single moment, in a single instant of my life, something in me had changed. Something had transformed. I, to take Dr. King's word, had been to the mountaintop. And after what I had seen, I could no longer be the same. Now, I'm not alone in this. In fact, I'd go so far to believe that most of us, if not all of us, have had mountaintop experiences before in our lives. They're few and far between, to be sure, but these are those moments when the distance between us and the divine is paper thin. When we feel the presence of God stirring so close to us, so visible, so real and tangible, it feels like you could just reach out and touch it. And we've had these moments before. Oftentimes, we hear about these moments when you hold your newborn child for the very first time. Or the moment when you meet your life partner, or when you declare your love for them and make that commitment to one another. Or maybe it's simply a moment when you, all of a sudden, after a life of denying who you really are, finally accept who it is you are and were meant to be. Or maybe these moments happen somewhere unexpected, at an unexpected moment, at an unexpected time. But whatever it may have been, whenever we may have felt it, once we've had these transformations, these mountaintop experiences, these transfigurations, we can no longer remain the same. Because something has fundamentally changed inside us. That the person we once were is no longer the person we are now. And that's terrifying. When the person that you are is no longer the person you once were, when the way that you knew the world, the very foundations of the world are now called into question, all of a sudden, all of the maps that we have charted, the plans that we have made are useless. As the world is completely new and different, and it is scary and it is exciting, and a whole new world of opportunities has opened. Because as we have been changed, the very world around us has changed as well. And I talk about this morning because it's the only way that I really feel like we can understand what it is that the disciples go through in the Transfiguration text this morning. It's how I have to imagine the disciples felt as they journeyed alongside Jesus up that mountain. Before their very eyes, the story from our text this morning tells us that they see Jesus donned in clothes of radiant white. And all of a sudden, pivotal figures from the Jewish faith appear beside him, with Moses and Elijah standing there conversing with him side by side. You know, it's hard to really describe what this would have been like for someone in that time, especially the disciples. We lose sight of the fact in our modern day that Moses and Elijah are arguably the two most important figures in the Jewish faith. It would be, I've been struggling trying to come up with an analogy, right? But if you simply take us as Americans, right, something that we all are, it would be like George Washington and Abraham Lincoln. And even that falls short of what it was, that what happened up there on that mountain. The impact that Moses and Elijah's presence have on the disciples, they are rendered speechless. Something incredible and indescribable had happened, something unexpected, something transformational. And they stammer, this disciples struggle to try to find the words to say, and they suggest building what are essentially shrines, churches, to honor these figures of this faith, to honor what it was that they just witnessed. But you can't stay up on the mountain forever. When you've been changed, when you've been transformed, you have to take what has happened to you and go out into the world. And so Jesus leads them back down out of the mountain and does something that I almost find comical. He orders them to secrecy. He tells them, don't share what happened on this day, at least not after, until I've died and has risen back from the grave. And I find it comical because even if the disciples had wanted to tell people what had happened, what on earth would they possibly say? Oh yeah, Jesus, yeah, all of a sudden, like it's a lightning bolt, and he's all of a sudden in these white robes, and oh, and you know, Moses and Elijah, yeah, those two most important figures of the faith, they were there too, and they had a little conference, and then we came back down the mountain. I'm totally not crazy, right? No, no, this is what happens. You can't describe a moment that has changed your life, that has fundamentally changed the course of who you are. When we have these moments, when we have these moments of transfiguration, it is impossible to adequately describe what has happened to others. They just don't get it. No matter what we say, no matter how we describe it, our words will always fall short. But you see, these moments of ours, these moments when we have experienced those mountaintop places, when we have felt and seen the presence of God so clearly in our lives, these are the moments we must treasure and hold on to. And while we may never be able to fully express them or describe them to others, the reality is they aren't meant for others. That moment was meant for you. These moments are testimonies of the way that God is still, even now, at work in our lives and in our world. This upcoming week, we enter into the season of Lent, a time of reflection and renewal that marks the time leading up to Holy Week, to the death and then the resurrection of Jesus on Easter morning. It is a time of reflection as we look at who we are and how we have come to be where we are today. And so I'm going to encourage us during the season of Lent to be intentional about remembering these moments, these mountaintop moments when we have felt the presence of God in our lives. Let us reflect upon them, relive them the best we can as we remember how God is still at work in this world even now. Let us remember how these moments have shaped us and helped us become the people that we were meant to be. Let us this Lent, as a faith community, continue to seek that mountaintop where we see the transfiguration of Christ with our own eyes. Thanks be to God. Amen. And so, my friends, on this day, I tell you indeed that God is good. I'm going to give you a C on that one, yeah. No, no, no. You're not just saying the words, you're feeling the words. I say to you indeed that God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Let us share the goodness of our God. Will you please join me as together we dedicate this morning's offering? Let us pray. With these gifts, we commit ourselves to follow a way that leads to love and life. May our sacrifice be witness to our love for each other and the God who loves us all. Amen. As we end our time together, I invite you now to either turn to the hymn, Noel, your black hymnal number 282, or look at the screen as we sing our sending hymn, Every Time I Feel the Spirit. Now, you may be seated as we have our commissioning. And I myself have a lot to get through this morning. Immediately after the service, if you are interested in becoming a new member here, I ask that you stay in the sanctuary. In fact, actually maybe move forward so that we're all a little bit closer. It'll be a short meeting, but I want to hand some information to you and properly prep you for that. So new members after worship, after the postlude, feel free to stick around. As I mentioned, this upcoming Wednesday is Ash Wednesday. It is also Valentine's Day, and after doing a cursory poll, it turned out that not a whole lot of people wanted to spend their Valentine's Day here at the church. So I don't know what it is, but what we're going to do, instead of doing an evening service, we are going to have drive-through ashes in the morning. So anytime between 8 to 9, whenever it is that you are able to get here before church, you just pull up to the front. I'll run outside, give you an ashes, a blessing, and you can be on your way to work. And then at 10 o'clock, for those who can make it, we're going to do a short, small service here in the sanctuary, 10 a.m. here in the sanctuary for Ash Wednesday. But we will not be having an evening Ash Wednesday service on Wednesday. I will also mention that as of tomorrow, fingers crossed, alongside of our new logo, our new marketing stuff, our new website should be launched officially starting tomorrow morning. So check in on that. A big thanks to Tom for helping make all that happen. It has been a long, yes. You will see when you see the website just how much has gone into this. It is night and day different from our current website. I'm very excited about it, so you'll want to check that out at some point this week. And then since we're starting our Lenten season, we are not going to have our Lenten discussion next Sunday because of a very special event that is going on to celebrate a very special someone who is turning 100, which means after worship next week, please join us as we celebrate Clarice and her 100 years on this earth, the blessing that she is to us. That'll be in their fellowship hall after worship. So please stick around for that, because you're going to be here anyway, right? Of course, you're going to come to church anyway. Actually, I hope you do, because as part of your Lenten series, I have something special to give you that you take home, that you work on throughout the course of the Lent. So you need to be here anyway. So I'll be taking attendance. Thank you very much. I will have your name. But that's it for me, and I know there's a lot of other things going on before I ramble too much. What other announcements, commissionings do we have? Yes.
Okay, I'm Shonda Duranlo, and I happen to be Jessica's mom.
Yes.
That you talked about. Yeah. And I told her that's what happens when you aren't in church. You get talked about.
Uh-huh.
She's used to that from me. So anyway, I'm also a minister. I retired in October, end of October. And for my retirement, my husband took me to Hawaii. And one of the things we did was we went to Maui, and we talked to some of the survivors of the fire, and we talked to the disaster minister over there, and they still need our help. I happen to have a niece who sells 31 products, and along with her, we're doing a fundraiser. You can find it on Facebook, Reviving Maui with Reverend Shonda. I don't know why we named it that, but she did it. But anyway, 10% of the proceeds go to Maui, and it'll go to the United Church of Christ Disaster Fund. There's some books here. I'll leave those out there. Her name's on here. If you want something, you can let me know, or you can send her a message and just say, it's for Maui. So,
and we will share that Facebook page on our Facebook page, so you can go to ours and you'll be able to be directed directly to where that's going to go. I will also mention, as Joan comes forward, because Lent is starting next week, we are going to be changing up our Sunday school timing. Are we doing that next week or 2 weeks from now? 2 weeks from now. Next week we're still doing, okay. Never mind. There will be no high school next week because of the party. And then it's in 2 weeks' time that we're changing up the schedule. Just ignore everything I said. Go ahead.
We, every year about this time, we keep track of our keys, who has a key and who doesn't. So if you have a key, could you either just email or let me know verbally or whatever, or let Robin know in the office, and then we'll know who has keys and who doesn't. And if for whatever reason you're a person that needs a key, then talk to me or one of the trustees.
Beautiful.
And you can get one.
Thank you, thank you. Any other commissioning announcements? Any of the above? Going once, going twice. Then let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord, to seek out those mountaintops in our lives when we can see and feel the divine with our own eyes. Let us go in peace. Amen.